Good morning, students. Today we will discuss the protocol to the American Convention on Human Rights. Okay, so we will be discussing the first protocol and the second protocol. The first protocol deals with the economic, social, and cultural rights, and the second protocol deals with the abolition of death penalty. Okay, so if we come to the first protocol, how the first protocol or why it was adopted was that we know that the American Convention on Human Rights, it was restricted only to the civil and political rights. Okay, it did not dealt with the economic, social, and cultural rights. So therefore, in order to safeguard economic, social, and cultural rights also, the state parties they felt the need of including the economic, social, and cultural rights also, so that those rights can also be realized and they can be made available to the people of the American states. Now, in pursuance of this, they made this first additional protocol, that is which is also known as the Protocol of San Salvador. Okay, now according to Article 77 of the American Convention on Human Rights, it provides that the state parties to the convention, they can submit protocols, so that the state parties, they can consider those protocols at the General Assembly of the Organization of American States. Okay, and therefore, this protocol, the first additional protocol, was also submitted in the same manner. Okay, and it was considered by the state parties to the convention. Okay, at the General Assembly of the Organization of American States, and there it was adopted. Okay, this protocol was it came into effect. It was adopted in 1988. Okay, so this is also known as the first additional protocol, is also known as the Protocol of San Salvador. Okay, and it furthers the human rights in the area of economic, social, and cultural rights. Okay, now this protocol, it was opened for signature on 17th November 1988. Okay, and this protocol came into force on 15th of November 1999. Now, the preamble of the protocol, it states the same thing that the preamble of the convention stated, okay, which we have already covered and we have discussed before. So this, the preamble of the protocol also, it states that it acknowledges that the essential rights of man, okay, they are not dependent on the man being a national of a certain state. Okay, so they are the essential rights of man, that means the fundamental basic rights, human rights of the individual, they are not dependent on the fact that the individual or the person, okay, he is a national of a particular state. Okay, but they derive from the they derive from the very personality of the human being. So that means they are inherent. Okay, they are inherent. So it says that it recognizes that the essential rights of man are not derived from one's being a national of a certain state, but are based upon attributes of human person. The same thing as was recognized in the preamble of the American Convention on Human Rights. And then it further acknowledges that there is a close relationship between economic, social, and cultural rights and civil and political rights. And it's important that both of them, they are given equal focus, and they are, both of them are simultaneously both of the realization of the both of both the rights, okay, they are taken up simultaneously by the states. So if we read this para that that is there in the preamble of the protocol, we find that in essence it encapsulates the entire concept of human rights. Okay, because it says that the considering the close relationship that exists between economic, social and cultural rights and civil and political rights, and that the different categories of rights constitute an indivisible whole based on the recognition of the dignity of the human person, for which reason both require permanent protection and promotion if they are to be fully realized. So earlier in the introductory classes to human rights also, we learned that human rights are indivisible and interdependent. Okay, so here the same thing is being acknowledged. Okay, and this paragraph of the preamble, it's telling us that the different rights, that means the economic, social and cultural rights and the civil and political rights, they together constitute, okay, human rights. They both of them together, they make up the content of human rights, and therefore human rights as such are indivisible. Okay, human rights are indivisible. And it also says that they both types of right, they require permanent protection and promotion, okay, if they are to be fully realized. And it further says that, and the violation of some rights in favor of the realization of others can never be justified. So as time and again we have discussed, okay, that there was, you know, for example, if we take the Marxist theory of human rights, the Marxist theory said that first preference has to be given to the economic, social and cultural rights rather than the civil and political rights. Okay, and some other some other theories, they give preference to the civil and political rights. Okay, so this is wrong. Okay, because both civil and political rights and economic, social and cultural rights, they together make up human rights, and the human rights, it is indivisible and they both are interdependent in nature. Okay, and therefore you cannot justify the violation of one type of rights, that means either the civil and political rights or the economic and social rights, to achieve the other set of rights. Okay, so Article 1, it says obligations to adopt measures. This is the same as we find in the American Convention. Okay, it says that where the rights that have been given under the the protocol, okay, where these are not already available, okay, then the state parties to the protocol, they will take necessary measures to adopt those rights. Okay, which will include legislative as well as other measures, so that progressive realization of these rights are achieved. Now, Article 2 again is the same as Article 3 is the same as we find in the American Convention, which talks about non-discrimination. So this Article 3 here is also a non-discrimination provision, which basically says that the rights that have been set forth in the protocol, okay, the state parties are under an obligation to ensure that those rights are exercised, okay, without any kind of discrimination. Now, Article 5, it talks about restrictions and limitations. We already know that no right is absolute. Okay, and reasonable restrictions can be put over the rights. Otherwise, the rights, it will become, it will destroy the very framework within which they are established. Okay, this is because a right which has no limitations and which becomes absolute, it will it will come into conflict with the rights of others. Because if you don't have any limitation and you can exercise your rights, then of course in the exercise of that right, okay, you will infringe, or you can infringe the right of others also. Okay, so that is not permissible. So this is why almost every right, it has certain limitations in the larger welfare of the society or the community, etc. Okay, so here Article 5, it also says that the state parties may establish restrictions and limitations on the enjoyment and exercise of the rights, okay, that have been established in the convention. But and these rights, these restrictions can be imposed so that the general welfare of the society, okay, that is preserved. Okay, but the restrictions and limitations, they have to be, they have to be put by way of law, by enacting a law. Okay, and they can only be put so in such a way that the limitations or the restrictions, they don't destroy the right itself, or they are not incompatible with the purpose and reasons underlying those rights. So a restriction on the right, it should not be such that it destroys the right itself. Okay, now Article 6 talks about right to work. Okay, and it says that everyone has a right to work, including the opportunity to secure means for living a dignified and decent existence. So of course, right to work is one of the most fundamental basic human rights. This is because if you don't have work, okay, then you cannot sustain yourself, okay, and your life will not have any purpose also. It's important for your material, mental and spiritual well-being that the individual, every individual, okay, works according to his capability, capacity and his free will, okay, and his desire. Okay, so right to work is one of the most essential rights. Okay, and it if you don't have work, you will not be able to live a dignified life, okay, because you will not have a means to support your existence. Okay, to means you will not have a means to support yourself, to sustain yourself. Now this right to work, it also includes conditions which will enable the individuals to effectively enjoy this right to work. So for that, it is also necessary that the that states provide certain benefits to the individuals. For example, benefits as in the sense of the right of the woman, okay, and the right to maternal leave, okay, maternal leave, etc. So all these rights should also be provided. At this right to work, it presupposes that any this right to work will be provided in a okay, this will be enjoyed in conditions which are just and equitable. Okay, so Article 7, it says that the right to work to which the foregoing article refers presupposes that everyone shall enjoy that right under just, equitable and satisfactory conditions. Okay, so in furtherance of this, for example, what makes, you know, just, equitable and satisfactory conditions so that an individual can enjoy the right to work? For example, minimum wages. Okay, the right to have minimum wages, this is one of the guarantees, okay, which will make the condition of the work, okay, just and equitable. Okay, the right to have fair and equal wages for equal work, okay, this will make the condition for of work, okay, just, equitable and satisfactory. So all these the right, it's not enough that the individual or the persons concerned, they are being provided with a right to work, but you also have to, along with that right, provide conditions which will enable the person to satisfactorily enjoy his right to work. Okay, you have to make the conditions, it should be just, equitable and satisfactory. For example, safety and hygiene at work, this is also which results into and which is necessary for the satisfactory conditions of work. Okay, so that the workers, so that the person concerned can enjoy his right to work. Now, it also includes reasonable limitation of working hours, both daily and weekly. So that is why you get one day off, as it's compulsory. Even if you go to many market areas, you will be, as I've already told you when we were discussing the ICCPR or ICSCR, that even if you go to the markets, okay, for example, some prominent market and all, you will find that even that market is closed for one day in a week. Okay, for example, that particular market will be closed on every Monday or every Tuesday or every Sunday. This is so that, you know, even those people, you know, those shop owners or whatever they are, showroom owners, etc., they can also enjoy they can also take rest. Okay, and if a person is not getting adequate rest, he cannot enjoy his work also. So that is why rest, leisure and paid vacations, as well as remuneration for national holidays, that is also included in the protocol. Now, Article 8 deals with trade unions. Trade unions basically are the workers. If you see the position of the worker, of course, is not equal to that of the employer. Okay, he is at a disadvantage, especially workers like the workers in big factories and there they are at a disadvantage. So in order to assert their rights and in order to make their voice heard and to increase their bargaining power, okay, they make associations or unions, which are known as trade unions. Okay, and which is one of the basic rights now. It's recognized as one of the basic rights to organize and join a trade union. Okay, and there can be more than one trade union at the same place. Okay, it's not necessary that there is only one trade union. So Article 8, it gives the right to workers to organize trade unions and to join the union of their choice. for the purpose of protecting and promoting their interests. How? Because the just as I told you just now, coming together, you know, if one person is demanding, he will not be heard. But if everybody, or if suppose out of 100, 70, 75 people are demanding the same thing, then that demand will be considered, okay, and it will have more weight. So if you come together and then if you demand, of course, you are in a better position to bargain. You have better bargaining capacity, okay, and you have a better chance to further your interest. Article 8.1b, it ensures the right to strike. But we already know that the right to strike is not a fundamental right. Okay. The right to strike is, resorted only when there is a conflict or difference between the management and the workers. Okay. And seeing that there is no other option, the workers resort to strike. Okay, but this is not an absolute right, and this is not a fundamental right. So para 2 of Article 8, it says that the above rights, that means the right to organize a trade union and to join a trade union, as well as the right to strike, okay, restrictions may be imposed on these rights in accordance with law. Now, Article 9 deals with the right to social security. Okay, in which under which para 1, it tells that everyone shall have the right to social security, protecting you from consequences of old age and of disability. Okay, and in the event of the death of a beneficiary, for example, if a worker who is working in the factory, he meets an accident, and so he will be given a compensation. Suppose he is not being able to work, okay, and he dies. So the compensation that he would have been getting, okay, is now his family, his dependents, they will be entitled to that. Similarly, in case of pension also, we see that suppose there is a person, okay, and he is getting pension, okay, now in case that old person dies, his dependent, that means his wife, will be entitled to get that pension. Okay, so this right is also given under the protocol. Para 2 of the article 9, it says that in the case of persons who are employed, the right to social security shall cover at least medical care and an allowance or retirement benefit in the case of work accidents or occupational disease, and in the case of women, paid maternity leave before and after childbirth. So this is one of, this is one of the essential rights in order to encourage the participation of women in, into the workforce, and enabling them to join the mainstream economy. Okay, this right of paid maternity leave before and after childbirth. Next, we come to Article 10, which covers right to health. So we already know that health is wealth. If you don't have, if you are malnourished, you are not getting proper, nutrition, etc., then you cannot be, you cannot come do your work also, okay, and you cannot enjoy your life also. You will not be able to participate in your daily activities as well as contribute to the welfare of the society or the progress of the society as well as. So you will be failing in both the areas, okay, individual development and progress as well as societal development and progress. Both will suffer if the people are not healthy. So Article 10 of the convention protocol, it provides right to health. Now one particular right that we will not generally find in other, you know, conventions, etc., that deal with economic, social, and cultural rights, is that the right to healthy environment. But we all know that even under, if you see the Indian laws and the Supreme Court cases, okay, on the subject, we know that now right to health in India as well as generally, okay, it is recognized as a fundamental right, okay, that is important for a person to enjoy his right to life, okay, a dignified life. So without a clean and healthy environment, you will not be able to enjoy a dignified life. So right to health is also important and has been provided by Article 11 of the protocol. And the obligation, it rests on the state. Okay, so para 2 says that the state shall promote the protection, preservation and improvement of the environment. Now, right to food. Now, we know that for a healthy, you know, for the people to have a healthy life, etc., they should also have adequate food, okay, adequate nutrition. So, the right to food has been provided under the protocol. And this, you know, right to food has also been, you know, recognized as one of the most basic and essential right. Okay, one of the most fundamental rights. So even under, if you see the Indian cases of the subject, you will find that the right to food has been, in India also, it has been recognized as a fundamental right. Okay. So PUCL case is there, or this, which is a Supreme Court case, PUCL versus Union of India, wherein the Supreme Court has recognized this right to food as a fundamental right. Now, para 2 says that in order to promote the exercise of this right, okay, that means the right to food, the right to have adequate nutrition, that the in order to promote the exercise of this right and eradicate malnutrition, the state parties undertake to improve methods of production, supply and distribution of food. So methods of production, okay, now we already know that you know, every day you will see in the news that new researches are being conducted so that we can, you know, we can increase our food grain production. For example, in India, the Green Revolution was undertaken. Why it was undertaken? Because we were also suffering from lack of adequate, you know, food stock. So India undertook Green Revolution, okay, and still we are conducting research. So you have seen this genetic modifications, hybrid varieties being developed so that we can increase the food production. So the, and awareness, you know, awareness among the farmers, giving them, you know, teaching them the right way, the right method, new techniques, whereby they can increase the food productions, increase their productivity. So the state parties, in order to eradicate malnutrition, they will undertake to improve methods of production, supply and distribution of food, and in pursuance of this, to achieve this end, they are also agreeing to promote greater international cooperation in support of the relevant national policies. So this is very important, because this is not restricted to only the responsibility of individual states, but here we see that the states here have recognized the need and effectiveness of international cooperation to achieve these rights, and they have agreed to promote greater international cooperation so that the right to food can be achieved, and malnutrition, etc., can be eradicated. So this is, in a sense, this is important, because in a sense this this is a kind of collective responsibility that the states are recognizing. Now we have the right to Article 13 talks about right to education, which we of course know that this is one of the most fundamental rights. And a human personality cannot be fully developed without basic education. So at least basic education has to be, the state has to endeavor to provide basic education to everybody. It is important so that full growth and development of the individual it takes place. Now parallel to it says that the education, it should be directed towards the full development of the human personality and human dignity, and to strengthen respect for human rights. If people are educated, it will strengthen the respect for human rights. Ideological pluralism, because education not only the purpose of education is not to give you information, or it's not information based, but the purpose of education is that you can appreciate what is right, what is wrong, and you can be more tolerant of others' ideologies and views also, and you can learn to live in peace together with other people, in coexistence with other people. That is the purpose of education, so that you can respect others' rights also. You are aware of your duty towards yourself, towards others, and towards the society. And you can contribute to the general welfare of the society and the country. So this is the purpose of education. So and an educated person, of course, people who are educated, they are more aware of their rights, and therefore they can effectively participate in a more they can effectively participate in a democratic society and help to maintain the plurality of the society. So it further says that the para 2 of Article 13, it further says, they further agree that education ought to enable everyone to participate effectively in a democratic and pluralistic society and achieve a decent existence, and should foster understanding, tolerance, and friendship among all nations and all racial, ethnic, or religious groups, and promote activities for the maintenance of peace. So education will not only help to achieve individual progress, individual personality, growth of individual personality, etc. But it, in the ultimate analysis, it will help to foster respect for human rights and justice and establish peace in the world and, result into a friendship among the people and among the nations. So some other rights that are provided under the protocol are the rights to the benefits of culture, the rights of children, protection of the elderly, protection of the handicapped, etc. Now, what are the means of protection or implementation of the rights that have been provided under the convention? So Article 19, it deals with the means of protection, okay, of the rights that have been provided under the convention. And Article 19, it says that that periodic reports, okay, periodic reports, the states, they will submit periodic reports on the progressive measures that they have taken to ensure the respect for and promotion and protection of human rights, okay, or the rights that have been given under the protocol. And these reports, they will be submitted to the Secretary General of the OAS, that is the Organization of American States. The Secretary General, once the reports have been submitted to the Secretary General will in turn submit those reports to the Inter-American Economic and Social Council and the Inter-American Council for Education, Science and Culture, so that the report that has been submitted, it can be examined. Okay. Now, a copy of this report is also supposed to be submitted to the Inter-American Commission on Human Rights so that it can also analyze the report and give its recommendations if needed. Now, Article 19, Para 6. Okay. With regard to the rights that have been provided under Article 8 and 13 of the protocol, that means the right. Article 8 talks about the right of the workers to organize trade union and to join trade union of their choice. And Article 13 talks about the right to education. So if the rights, if both of these rights, they are violated, okay, by any conduct which can be directly attributable to the state party, to the protocol, that means they have been, they have been violated by a law that has been, this can be one of the examples that they have been, these rights, they have been violated by any law that has been enacted by the state or any policy that the state has enacted or any executive order of the state, etc. If whichever way, okay, the violation takes place, and if that violation, it can be attributable to the, you can say that this has happened because of the conduct of the state. The state is responsible for the violation of these rights. Then in that case, the system of individual petition, okay, it will come into play. And for the violation of these rights, their individual petitions can be submitted, okay, to the Inter-American Commission on Human Rights or through the Inter-American Commission to the Inter-American Courts also. So in this way, in the case of both these rights, this is a special means of protection that Article 19 provides. So here we finish the first protocol to the American Convention on Human Rights. The second protocol is, a very simple protocol. We have already done this. The second protocol deals with the abolition of death penalty. And we know that death penalty has already been extensively covered under the convention itself, but still the states, they chose to to enter into a protocol for this purpose, so that their commitments towards the abolition of death penalty, they can be reinforced. Okay, so we have now here we finished our two protocols to the American Convention on Human Rights. I hope that you will I'll be providing you the material and the copy of the of these protocols. I expect that you will at least once go through the bare provisions in the protocol. Okay, and if of course there is any problem, you can always write to me. Okay, so thank you, take care.